हरे कृष्णा, इज इट ऑडिबल?
हरे कृष्ण पूजे, ऑडिबल ऑडिबल,
हरे कृष्ण पूजे के।
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु, इट इज ऑडिबल।
हरे कृष्ण, सो वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू फॉर टुडेज भगवद गीता रीडिंग सेशन। सो होप ऑल ऑफ यू हैव डन श्लोका मेमोराइजेशन। So let us start with that one by one, and then we will start with our today's discussion. Yes. Yes, so we have Anurag Prabhu joined after many weeks. So I hope you are aware about the shloka memorization. Could you do it, Anurag Prabhu? हरे कृष्ण,
हरे कृष्ण प्रभु।
हरे कृष्ण,
हरे कृष्ण। या अनुराग प्रभु, कैन यू रिपीट अगेन? आई कुडंट हियर यू सम। नॉट एबल टू हियर। ओके अभिषेक प्रभु, कैन यू स्पीक?
यस, हरे कृष्ण प्रभु जी, दंडवत प्रणाम।
हाँ, हरे कृष्ण, दंडवत प्रणाम। ओके, सो इट्स कमिंग। ओके, हरे कृष्ण। सो यस अभिषेक प्रभु, कुड यू रिसाइट द श्लोकस?
यस प्रभु जी, आई एक्चुअली रीड ओनली वन प्रभु जी, 9.4।
ओके, प्लीज रिसाइट।
यस प्रभु जी, मया ततम इदं सर्वं जगत अव्यक्ता मूर्तिना मत्स्थानि सर्वभूतानि न चाहं तेषव अवस्थिता।
जय हरि बोल। ट्रांसलेशन,
लॉर्ड कृष्णा सेज दैट बाय हिज पावर एवरीथिंग इन दिस मटेरियल वर्ल्ड एक्सिस्ट विद इन हिम, बट ही डजंट लाइक like within everything he doesn't exist, but everything exists within him.
Yeah, almost correct. Yeah, basically Krishna is telling, I am pervading all over the entire universe in my unmanifested form, and all living beings are in me, but I am not in them. So little puzzle kind of thing. We will discuss this, how it comes and all. Thank you Abhishek Prabhu. So next we have Jitendra Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Dandavat Pranam.
Yeah.
Yeah. I have recited 9.4.
Yes.
Okay. The sloka is, Maya tatam idam sharvam jagad avakta murtinah mat sthani sharva bhutani na chaham tesh avastita.
Haribo.
Translation, why me in my unmanifested form? This entire universe is pervaded in me, and all living beings, all the beings are in me, but I am not in.
Yeah, Hari Bol, very nice. So thank you Jitendra Prabhu. Next is Suraj Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Yes Suraj Prabhu, please recite.
Yes, provided. Aujananti ma moda manushim tanumashritam parambhava maheshwaram.
Haribo.
Fools deride me when I descend in the human form. They do not Lord.
Yes, correct. Hari Bol. Very nice. This is the 11th shloka, which we will be covering in the next Sunday reading. Thank you. Next, we have Rajendra Prabhu. Could you memorize the shlokas?
Sorry, Prabhuji, I have not memorized.
Not memorized. No problem. Next, we have Tapan Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
I have memorized 9.1, 9.2, and 9.10, Prabhu.
Okay, 9.10, you can tell.
Okay, Prabhuji. माया अध्यक्षेन प्रकृति सुवेते साचराचरम हेतु अनेन कौन्तेय जगत विप्रा विवर्तते. The Lord is telling in this that material energy is working under him and all the moving and non-moving objects is producing it is also through one of his energies only. And under his energy only this universe is being created, cosmic manifestation is being created and annihilated.
Yeah, very correct. Hari Bol.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Then we have Teja Bro.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna.
I will recite 9.4 Prabhu.
Yeah.
Maya tadamidam sarvam jagata vyakta murtinamastani sarvabhutani nachaham. By me, it means that Krishna is saying, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded, spread through Prevaist. Means Vishvam Vishnu. In the Sastranam of Vishnu Sastram, the first word is says Vishvam Vishnu. That means the total universe is in Krishna only. And all beings are in me. And all are the beings, all are the living creature and all the living creatures are in Krishna, but I'm not in them. Means the Krishna is saying something like puzzle that I am there, but I'm not in there. Means we can, for this, we can know, means if we can't see Krishna, it's not the correct procedure. If one will have glory or to listen glory or to know the glories of Krishna, he should have a proper guidance and he should have a devotion and bhakti towards Krishna. Only he can listen or he can stay with Krishna. As well as in Brahma Samhita, it is there. Santahasa Devarudhi Yeshu Viloktayani. It means if you have a great devotion towards Krishna, then you can see the Krishna in universe as well as in you. That's it, Krishna. That's it, Prabhuji.
Yeah, thank you. Nice. Yeah, explain the verse also, how it comes and everything. Hari Bol.
Hari Bol.
Yeah, so thank you, Teja Prabhu. Next, we have Vijay Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. I have not remembered any verse, but previously Prabhuji, I know that Maya Dakshana Prakruti.
Okay.
So, Maya Dakshana Prakruti Suyate Se Chara Chara Hetunane Ya Konteya Jagat Vipa Rivartate. And the meaning as Tapan Prabhu told, all this material universe is one of the energy of Lord, and Lord said, Oh, son of Kunti, like all moving and non-moving things are there. All are in the direction of that creation which Lord had done, under that direction it comes.
Jai Hari Bol. Nice. Thank you. So next we have Vinay Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu. I want to recite 9.10 sloka. Maya adhyakshena prakruti suyate sacharacharam anena kaunteya jagat viparivartate.
Hari Bol.
This material nature is energies of Krishna only, and Krishna is explaining to Arjuna this all planets are annihilated again and again from him only.
Hari Bol. So nicely recited. Next one we have Aditya Prabhu. Yes, Aditya Prabhu is there. Okay, Anurag Pro, you can recite.
Sarvabhutani Kaunteya Prakritam Yanti Mamaikam Kalpashaya Punatani Kalpadau Visrajami Aham. Krishna is explaining that all the material manifestation are his creation, and after the ending of all the material manifestation, it goes into him only, and with his potency only all these manifestation are created.
Yeah. Haribol. Which was this text, verse number?
9.7, Prabhu.
9.7. Oh. We are not given, I think, that in option.
Actually, I tried to look from 9.4 to 10. I found it.
Okay, like that. No problem. Nice. Haribol. So next we have Sangameshwar Pro. Yes, Sangameshwar Pro. He is connecting just now. Yes, Sangameshwar Pro, would you like to recite?
No problem. No. Recite.
Okay. Hare Krishna. So all are done. Very good. Okay, so now we will start with our Bhagavad Gita discussion. So let us have some short prayers before that. Om Agyanti Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunvinitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine. Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashyata Deshitarine. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavanda. Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. So very happy to see all of you today present here on this Sunday evening. So as all of you know, we have already started with chapter 9. And we have covered the first three verses of that. So the first verse of this 9th chapter, it is telling about basically the knowledge, because if you see the chapter name, it is most confidential knowledge. So the first verse which Krishna spoke here, it started with that who is eligible to get knowledge. Krishna says that one who is not envious of me, because Arjuna was like that, that's why I am giving this knowledge to you. And then in the second verse, there are 8 characteristics of this knowledge comes, because we have seen that from the Bhagavad Gita when we start chapter 1, chapter 2. So chapter 1 was not about, Krishna did not speak anything. Krishna started speaking from chapter 2. So chapter 2 to chapter 6, these are the, we can say, confidential knowledge of we are not this body, but we are a spirit soul and all that. And karma yoga, how we should do it as an offering to Lord and like that. And then 7th and 8th chapter was more confidential, because there we came to know more things about Lord, how Rasom Apsukanteya and Prabhasmi Shashi Surya Yeho, and like that many places Krishna tells about his own energies and greatness about the Lord. That has been explained. That is much more confidential knowledge. Because when we tell that, okay, you are not this body, you are a spirit soul. So that time there is no positive part given for the soul. It is just said that you are not this body. But what the soul is supposed to do, that was told in the 7th and 8th chapter. That is more confidential knowledge. And this particular chapter is most confidential, because in this chapter, the further level of advancement, that is pure devotional service, is given, where patram pushpam phalam tayam and such kind of verses are there. Manmana bhava mad bhakto, offer me your obeisances and respectful, all those things come in that particular verses. So, and you may think that, oh, all these things we already know, then how it is most confidential? Because the thing is, we have seen in the last few verses also, that Prabhupada actually gives Bhakti Yoga, that is this most confidential knowledge, in each purport in the entire Bhagavad Gita. So even if you read first chapter, second chapter, everywhere Bhakti Yoga is given. But when Krishna is telling to Arjuna, he is telling one by one. So Krishna started telling about Bhakti Yoga just now in this chapter. 7th, 8th and 9th is the third chapter where he is telling about Bhakti Yoga. But Prabhupada, out of his compassion, because there will be some people, they just read one chapter and then they close the Bhagavad Gita. So they should also get Bhakti Yoga. And that's why Prabhupada, in his purport, out of his compassion, he has already told the process. Like even when we see that when Ashtanga Yoga was going on, Prabhupada said that, oh, one should chant Hare Krishna. So that is a Bhakti Yoga process Prabhupada gave in the previous chapters itself. So now we are on the fourth verse. So this was about second verse, the eight characteristics of Bhakti, and 9.3, that was the qualification of who can get this knowledge or achieve this knowledge. That one who is non-envious and one who has faith. So these two people can only receive the knowledge properly. So now coming to the next verse, that is fourth verse, and this one we are going to take today. So today's topic is very wonderful. This is about Lord, how he is in this, he has done everything in this world, but he is not attached to it or he is not dependent on it. Yeah, all are able to see the Bhagavad Gita, this verse 9.4.
Yes, Prabhuji.
Yeah. Please recite this verse after me. Maya tatamidam sarvam.
Maya tatamidam
sarvam.
Jagad avyakta murtina.
Jagad avyakta murtina.
Mastani sarva bhutani.
Mastani sarva bhutani.
Nachaham teshva vastitaha.
Nachaham teshva vastita.
Okay, so yeah, let us read the translation. Yes, Anurag Pro can read translation. Yes.
Yeah, Prabhu. By me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them.
Yeah, by me, but in my unmanifested form, entire universe is pervaded. So here, if you see the verse, Maya tatam idam sarvam, that means I am present everywhere. Now, when one hears this, I am present everywhere, Krishna is saying that. And all people actually in this world, they want to know, where is God? Please show me God. So when they hear something like this, that I am present everywhere, immediately first question comes in their mind is, where is God? Why I am not able to see if he is everywhere? So then here Krishna says, Jagat avyakta murtina. That means avyakta murtina means I am present by my unmanifest form. So by our normal senses, we can't see that because it is unmanifest. Vyakta murti means the deity which is in the temple. But avyakta means there is no deity. It's like he's spreading everywhere in his impersonal feature. Matastani sarva bhutani. That means all beings are me. Sarva bhutani, all the living entities, sarva bhuta, they are in me. Na chaham teshu avasthita, but I am not in them. That is what Krishna is telling in this verse. Yeah. So basically this verse onwards, fourth verse till 10th verse, these verses are about Krishna's energies, how Krishna is, basically Krishna's relationship with the world in which we are living in. So what is that relationship? Because many times we know about Krishna, we know about this world, but we don't know what is the relationship and how Krishna is actually managing all the things. And so those things are going to be clear in these few verses. So here when Krishna says, all beings are in me, but I am not in them. So, and of course, many of you already know this philosophy that Lord is there as a super soul within our heart. So now, is it not contradictory to say that I am not in them? Krishna says, I am not in them, but he is there in every living entity as a super soul in their hearts. So anyone want to tell why Krishna is saying what he is saying?
Yes, Prabhu. In purport, I already read the purport and there is written that.
What is
so, they're written that it is just like a kingdom. They have given one example, Prabhupada given one example of kingdom. There is a kingdom
and below the kingdom there are many departments. So means if the order is pervaded by the king, then it is flow through the those departments. Somebody is if there is no king, then there will be no department. If somebody is there and he is following the particular department, so he follow that department, and it means that all the power coming through the king, and he following the all he just order the all the department. So Krishna is like that. He is the king is there, but all the departments working under him. So we see the department only.
Yes, correct. So king's that example comes. So just keep this with you. I am again going to discuss this example of king. Before that, I want to tell that as it was said in this verse that by my unmanifest form, this entire universe is pervaded. So I was in that point that people want to see where is God, why I am not able to see God. So immediately that question arises, where is God? So just one short clip I want to show you through this, which is Prabhupada clip itself, what Prabhupada tells about this. Because many people ask, where is God? Can you show me God? So Prabhupada is giving answer to that question here. It's a short clip. I will play for all of you. Yeah.
Bhagavatam. Third.
Coming up is very is a fact. Form Krishna can be seen with the answer both day and night. You cannot work.
Yeah, all are able to hear, no? Okay. So I'm playing this clip. It's just 2 minutes I will play. What Prabhupada is telling about, if somebody asks, can you show me God?
You are very much proud of your eyes. Can you show me God? The answer will be, have you got the eyes to see God? You rascal, you want to see God. Have you got the eyes to see God? No, sir. Then why you want to see God?
So here Prabhupada is saying that he is very boldly is telling that you want to see God, but do you have the eyes to see God? Because our eyes are imperfect. We can't see God with our this imperfect eyes. So how can you tell to show God? Then he asks like that and the person says, no, sir. Then why you are asking them? And now Prabhupada will tell who can see God.
God can be seen in a different way. God can be seen premanjana churita bhakti bilochanena. When you will be devotee, lover of God, then by that ointment your eyes will be cleared and you will be seeing God. Now here is God. Krishna, here is God. Why the people in Bombay, they are challenging, can you show me God? They do not come here. Because they have no love. A few devotees here, they understand that here is God. They can see, here is God. The rascals, they cannot see God. See, even though he has got eyes, he cannot see God.
Yeah, so who can see God? First Prabhupada said that you can't see God because you don't have eyes. Then what he says, who can see God?
Who has devotion towards Krishna and love towards Krishna?
Yeah, one who is having the devotion, one who is practicing pure devotional service, he can actually see Krishna. So this is how Prabhupada tells, you can't see Krishna, but when you become pure, then you can see Krishna because Krishna reveals himself. So that is the main thing. So this is about seeing. So there are one category of people, they are not able to see because of imperfect vision, imperfect senses. And one category, that is pure devotees, they are able to see Krishna. So now we are in between. We are neither into karmi, neither we are pure devotee. So what about us? How can we see Krishna? So Krishna tells in, Prabhupada is telling in this purport itself that actually we are a practicing sadhaka and we cannot see Krishna directly, but we can see Krishna through the scriptures. Like we have Bhagavad Gita, we have Srimad Bhagavatam, where we understand that how God can be revealed. And we read that those scriptures, and through those scriptures, we are able to see God. So that is the beauty of this particular literatures, spiritual literatures. So going next. Yeah. So here, so just now you read this verse. So again, coming to this, what Jitendra Prabhu told, the story about king and heading the government. So all beings are me. That means king is there and everybody is dependent on the king in that particular kingdom. Everybody is accepting their whatever salary or whatever they are getting from the king, they are satisfied with that. So they are depending on the king. So all beings are in him, but he is not in them, means he is not abide by those rules and regulations or anything, because he is the king of that. And what Prabhupada is telling here also, that king does not need to go in personally into each and every department. So that is not required. Whereas so similarly, God also like that. God need not go to each and every person, but all beings are in him. So two things we understand here, that Lord is pervaded everywhere. All beings are in him, but he is not in them. So now let us see. Yeah, so and but Krishna says that I am super soul present in everyone. But here he is saying that I am not in them. So basically he want to say that many acharyas and superiors, which I have heard from, they said that I am not in them is I am not dependent on them. That means like a rich man, you see that there is a rich man and he goes to some home where people are not being properly given food or something. So he goes to that home, he starts maintaining those people. He has money, he brings a lot of vegetables, grocery, everything, cooking for them. He arranges for everything, their food, clothing, shelter, everything he arranges. So he becomes like a main person. He's like owner of that particular home. So now nobody can say that, oh, he also must be affected by because of all this thing. But no, he is above them. He is not into the category of those people because he is the maintainer and all others are subordinate to him. And one day maybe there some beggar also may come in the same home and he may think, oh, very nice food and all you are getting, so let me also stay in the home only. But then he is dependent on the master. So that's how he will be dependent person. But the rich man, he is independent. So he is not among them. So that is what Krishna is telling, that I am not in them means I am in them, but I am not affected by them or I am not dependent on them. So that is what Krishna is telling in this particular verse when he says, I am not in them. So this is the first verse, which we see that all beings are in me. I am also in them, but I am not dependent on them. That is the meaning of I am not in them. So this is one thing. And in the next verse, Krishna is going to say the opposite also. So let us see what is that. Just now Krishna says that, here you can note this line also. Sometimes people change their words, no? So we note the words, what they have said in the previously and later. So here Krishna is telling, Matsani Sarvabhutani. Now next verse, it starts with opposite of what he has said in this particular verse. Let us go to chapter text 5. So see here. Oh, what was written? Matastani Sarvabhutani. It was written like that. And now here what is written?
Nacha Matastani Bhutani.
Yeah, Nacha Mastani Bhutani. That means completely opposite. There he said Mastani Bhutani. That means all beings are in me. And here he says that they are not in me. So let us recite this verse. Nachamastani bhutani.
Nachamastani bhutani.
Pashyame yogameshwaram.
Pashyame
yogameshwaram.
Bhutabhunna cha bhutasto.
Bhutabhunna cha bhutasto.
Mamatma bhutabhavanah.
Mamatma
bhutabhavanah.
So nachamastani bhutani. That means I am not in them. Yes, Tejapru.
And yet everything this is created does not rest in me. Behold my mystic opulence, although I am the maintainer of all living entities, and although I am everywhere, I am not a part of this cosmic manifestation for myself in the very source of creation.
Yeah, so many things he is telling in this particular verse. Main thing is, everything that is created does not rest in me. That is one thing it tells, does not rest in me. Another Krishna is telling that, although I am the maintainer, now he is giving the reason why he said what he said. So here he says, yet everything that is created does not rest in me. So he gives reason that, although I am the maintainer of all living entities and I am everywhere, but I am not part of that cosmic manifestation because I am only the source of that. So source, if you have created something, so source of that particular creation cannot be affected by those things, or he cannot be involved into that. Like you create something, you will not be inside that because you are outside creating those things. So God is creating all this material universe, everything. So he is not in that because he is able to create, means he is beyond this creation. So that is what is Lord. And in this particular verse, Krishna says that I does not rest in them, although I am the maintainer of all living entities. So basically Krishna want to tell, when he says that all beings are not in me or they does not rest in me, actually they rest in him only. But Krishna is telling that, that means that even though they rest in me, but I am not attached to them. So that's how they does not rest in me. It's like that. So I am not the part of them. I am not taking part in that cosmic manifestation. And at the same time, I am detached. So even though these beings are resting in me, but I am detached to them, and that's why Krishna says, does not rest in me. So that is what being told here. So because he is the source of creation, the source cannot, like you make something, other person can enter into that, but the creator cannot go there, because creator only is the creator of that particular thing which he has created. Yeah, so basically, yeah, so here we see one more conception that something is being created by you, anything, it is your production. So we become very much attached to that. We think that, okay, this is, I have created this. So we become, there is some feeling of attachment or emotions are being attached. Like suppose you make some very good project for your, in your college or in your company, you make a project. And when the success happens, you, naturally it comes that, okay, this is my projector, I have made this. Or sometimes you draw some painting, so then you feel that I have created this. People write their names also down that, oh, this is being painted by this person. So we feel some kind of accomplishment, or we become attached to that. And somebody says something wrong about that creation, then we feel angry also. I have done such nice work, but still this person is not able to appreciate. Or sometimes, suppose you have made, some of you are cooks here, so you must have made some very nice, some item you have made, food item, some sweets, some halwa you have made, and you want to tell to everyone that, okay, I have made it. And when everyone tests, then we get some kind of accomplishment that, okay, I have cooked it and many people liked it. But here, so there is some kind of attachment. If somebody says good, then we feel good. If somebody says bad, then we feel, oh, why they are saying like this. So that's how we become attached. Emotionally, we become attached to our own creation. So, but here Krishna says, I am detached from them. So even though I create everything, so this is the quality of Lord. He is the greatest renouncer also. He can create the things, at the same time, he is not attached to them. Somebody creates a building, he becomes attached to building. The mother, father comes and beget a child, they become attached to the child. So whatever creation one makes, he becomes attached to that. But Lord is such a renouncer that he doesn't get attached to his own creation. He is aloof from them, he is detached from them. And that's why Krishna is telling in this verse that everything is created, does not rest in me. So they rest in him, but he is not attached to them. So that's how it does not rest in him. So that is what is given in this purport also. Okay, let us read the some part of the purport. Only few lines. Yes, Teja Prabhu, please read this.
The Lord explains this fact, although he is maintainer and sustainer of the entire material manifestation, he does not touch the material manifestation simply by his supreme will. Everything is created, everything is sustained, everything is maintained, and everything is annihilated.
Yeah. So although he is the maintainer of everything, but he does not touch the material manifestation. So he's just a creator, creates and he is aloof. He is not into that. So we are going to discuss many examples also, how he is aloof from that. It will come in the next few verses. And next verse itself is example. So let us see the text number 6. Please recite after me. Yathakashastito nityam.
Yathakashastito
nityam.
Vayu sarvatra gomaha.
Vayu sarvatra gomaha.
Tatha sarvani bhutani.
Tatha sarvani bhutani.
Matastani tyupadharaya.
Under that, as the mighty wind blowing everywhere rests always in the sky, all created things rests in me.
Yeah, so as the mighty wind blowing everywhere rests always in the sky, all created being rest in me. So see, again it has changed. So first verse he says all beings are in me. Second time he says that they does not rest in me. Now he says again that they rest in me. So you understood why he said what he said. Every time the thing was different. And here he says that all created beings rest in me, and the rest always in the sky. All created being rest in me, but like a sky is not affected by the wind. Like if you see, the sky is there everywhere and the wind will have that space is occupied by the wind, and wind goes everywhere. Wind can go to different things also, but ultimately it comes under the sky only. It cannot go beyond sky. So it has to be under sky only. So similarly, the living entities are in Krishna, or they are dependent on Krishna, but Krishna is not into them, or that means Krishna is not affected by them. The sky is never affected. Where the wind is going today, it is not flowing this way, that way. The sky is aloof in his own position. He is not much affected by the activities of the wind. Whereas we get affected. If the wind is very strong, we feel very, it's like some storm is going to come. So we become very fearful. Or sometimes the wind is very hot in the summer season. Then we feel very troublesome or distressed that why this hot air is coming. And the cool air comes, we feel very happy. So we get affected by the wind, but sky is not affected. Whether cool, whatever happens, the sky is not attached to where the wind is flowing. So that is the speciality of the sky. So that's how the Lord is also like that. Lord doesn't get affected by our activities or the activities of the material world. Yes, we'll read one little thing from the purport. Yeah, please read this.
As we generally say, not a blade of grass moves without the will of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Thus, everything is moving under his will. By his will, everything is being created, everything is being maintained, and everything is being annihilated. Still, he is aloof from everything, and sky is always aloof from the activities of the wind.
Yeah, so here Prabhupada is explaining like that. Not a single blade of grass moves without the will of the Supreme Lord. So Lord is only doing everything, and Lord is creating, Lord is only maintaining, Lord is annihilating, Lord is only giving sanctioning the desires of living entities. Everything is done by Lord, but at the same time, he is not being affected by the activities of this world neither by the activities of the living entity. So he is aloof from them. Yes. Next verse, seventh verse. Please recite. Sarvabhutani Kaunteya.
Sarvabhutani
Kaunteya.
Prakritim Yanti Mamikam.
Prakritim Yanti Mamikam.
Prakritim Yanti Mamikam.
Kalpakshaye Punastani.
Kalpakshaye Punastani.
Kalpada Visrujamyaham.
Kalpada Visrujamyaham.
Okay. So, yes, Rajendra Prabhu, please read translation.
Pusana Punti, at the end of millennium, all material manifestation enter into my nature. And the beginning of another millennium, by my potency, I create them again.
So here, Krishna is telling the process of creation and annihilation, how it happens. So what Krishna is telling? At the end of the millennium, all material manifestations enter into my nature. And at the beginning of another millennium, again, by my potency, I create them. Who is that potency? Who creates again? Yes. Who is that potency?
Krishna.
Krishna is creating by his potency. Who is that?
Radha.
No, who is the in charge of creation?
Durga.
Durga Mata.
Yeah.
Brahma.
Yeah, Brahma. Brahma is the in charge of our creation. So Brahma is creation, Vishnu is maintainer, and Shiva is the destructor. So of course, Brahma creates different planetary systems, and that's how the living entity. Original creator is Krishna only, and everybody is coming from the Supreme Lord, the Garbhadaksha Vishnu. Everybody was lying, and then everyone starts coming. So that is there. But the creator, by my potency, basically is telling that okay, Brahma created. Here also you see, Krishna is explaining that Brahma's lifetime and how he creates. So there are different types of what we say pralaya, which happens in this world. So one pralaya happens after the day of Brahma, which we have seen last time also. When the day of Brahma completes, when the night starts, then everything gets annihilated. When Brahma sleeps, everything annihilates. And then next day again he gets up, and again he has to create all the planetary systems, everything. And another destruction happens, or annihilation happens, that is at the end of Brahma's life. When one Brahma is finished, his 100 years are gone, when he dies, then again there is complete annihilation. Again the next Brahma comes, and again he has to create everything. So these are two types of pralaya, that's destruction. One more destruction is which is going on constantly. Like we see the leaves on the tree, it falls down. So everything is as such just getting destroyed. Nothing is coming, some new things are not coming. So that is also called continuous nitya pralaya, we say. It's a continuous destruction happening. And one is authentic pralaya, where one's false ego is destroyed. So that is also one kind of pralaya. So four types of pralaya are there. So that's how. So here it is tell about at the end of Brahma's millennium, that is Kalpakshaya. Again, he has to create. So those things also are done by the Supreme Lord himself. Let us go to the next verse, text 8. Please recite this. Prakritim Swama Vashtabhya.
Prakritim Swama Vashtabhya.
Visru Jami Puna Puna. Bhutagramam Imam Krishnam.
Bhutagramam Imam Krishnam.
Avasham Prakritet Vashat. Yeah, yes, Jitendra Prabhu, translation. Yes, Jitendra Prabhu is there.
Yes, Prabhu, sorry, Prabhu, one call is there. Translation. Okay. The whole cosmic order is under, and my will, it is annihilated at the end.
Yeah, correct. Whole cosmic order is under me. Under my will, it is automatically manifested again and again. and under my will it is annihilated at the end. So again, the continuation of the last verse, it is coming that how it is happening. But here Krishna says that avashat, that is automatically manifested again and again. What does it mean? That actually every living entity, because we take birth in this world, we come here. But if you see, there are some free will is given that, okay, you can do whatever you want, and then according to our karma, we degrade or we ascend. Different things happen according to our karma, it happens. So, but what is given here is automatically manifested again and again. That means we don't have control over it, because laws of nature, it is not under our control. It is under Krishna's control, Maya Dakshina Prakriti. So it is not under our control. So we can't do anything with that. We have to just obey. We have choice to do what to do when, but we can't decide our birth, when it should happen. We can't decide our death. So these things are not being decidable. So choice is not with the jiva's hands. So that's why it is said automatically the manifestation is happening. Okay. So this was the main thing in this. It's a continuation from the last verse, that how creation annihilation is taking place. That is what Krishna is explaining here. So now it's number 9. Nachamam tani karmani.
Nachamam tani karmani.
Nibadhananti dhananjaya.
Nibadhananti dhananjaya.
Udasinam adasinam.
Udasinam adasinam.
Asaktam teshu karmasu.
Asaktam teshu karmasu.
Yes, basically nibadhananti. Nachamam tani karmani. The nibadhananti means it doesn't bind me. Bandhanti means it binds, the work binds. But nibadhananti means it does not bind. So what? Who is not bound by this things? Let us see. Is that person we or is it Krishna? Yes. Yes, who can read? Sangameshwar, who can read? Translation.
Yes, sir. O Dhananjaya, all this work cannot bind me. I am ever detached from all these material activities, seated as though neutral.
Yeah. So the work cannot bind Krishna. It can bind us, but not Krishna. And I am ever detached from all these material activities as if neutral. Udasinavat. So I am neutral. I am not affected by that. And this work, it is actually binding me into that. It is not binding me, Krishna, but it is binding all of us. So we see that any work is done in this world, immediately you get reaction for that. If the work is not Krishna conscious, then immediately we have to take reaction. Whatever work one does, immediately the reaction will come. And that reaction will bind us, because the only reaction which will not bind us is the reaction of the spiritual activities we do. For that, there will not be any reaction. But any material activity one does, immediately the reactions will catch us. But we get we get reactions also, and we get bound also by our work. Like sometimes there are, like Krishna has created so much universe, everything. One may think that, okay, I have created it, I have to maintain, and he becomes attached to that, then he is not able to give it up. So when the creation is annihilated, one will feel so pain. Oh, I have made it with such more effort and such so much time and energy I have given, but this entire creation is again destroyed. So one may feel little morose. But Krishna is very neutral. Even though so much annihilation happening, destruction, creation, so many things are happening, but Krishna is saying that I am neutral, I am detached from all material activities. Whereas just imagine a person, like we sometimes make a building, some home we have made, and little scratch goes to the home, we immediately feel, oh, how can it happen? Who has done it? And immediately we take a stick and chase after them. Or a person becomes so attached that even at the end of his life also, he is thinking about his property, my farm, my land, my cows, of course, cow is a good thing. But they think about their jewelry or whatever money, stock, wealth, those things, they become attached to that. And even when they die, because there are some people there, the stories comes in Bhagavatam, that these people were so much attached to their land and property that they became rat in the same land, or some became snake, or some became dogs to take care of that particular land. So that is our position, that whatever work we do, we become attached to that. We become attached to our own creation. But when it comes to the Supreme Lord, he cannot be bound by all this. So that's why Krishna says, oh, Dhananjaya. That means, Dhananjaya means, what is the meaning of Dhananjaya? Why Krishna is addressing as Dhananjaya?
Conqueror of all wealth.
Yes, Dhananjaya means Dhana, Dhanvisan. It's a wealth. So conqueror of wealth is Arjuna. There is a pastime where Arjuna actually got a lot of wealth and all. So that's why he's referred to as Dhananjaya. But even though, so he's basically preferring to him that you are conqueror of wealth, but I am conqueror of everything because nothing can bind me. So work cannot bind me. I am ever detached from these activities as if neutral. Yes. Okay, what is the time? 5-6 minutes are there still. So, and one more verse is there. So let us read some translation of this. Next verse is a little bigger also. Yeah, see here it is said, although he has control over every minute detail of material activities, he is sitting as if neutral. Just imagine if a company, some boss is there and he's just sitting without even attachment to the company, without even thinking about the profit or loss, what is going to come. So he is not thinking, he's just neutral. So it is sure that the company will go in loss. And there will be a lot of cheatings will happen because material world people will exploit, so many things will happen because the boss is not much caring what is going happening in my particular project or my company. He's very neutral, so nobody will work responsibly. But it is not true with Krishna. When Krishna says that I am neutral, at the same time Krishna is, everything is happening Krishna's sanction only, nothing is independent of him. So in that way, this is a unique thing which we can see here with the Lord. And here Prabhupada is giving the example of high court judge. Like high court judge, he can make so many decisions, but is he attached to those decisions? Like sometimes by his one decision a person may be hanged, he may have to leave his life, or sometimes he may have to go into jail for years together, or sometimes one will be awarded nice good amount of money because of winning some particular wealth or property case or something like that. So in that way, different people, some are getting awards, some are getting punishment. But is the court, high court judge, is he affected by that? Yeah. So you know, obviously, because he is just making a decision. He is like the judge of that. He is just making a judgment and he is unaffected because neither this party belongs to him or not that party. So that's why he is aloof from that. So Prabhupada is giving that example here. Also, there is example of sun. Like sun, because of rising of the sun, you know this bee, when bee is there, it actually lies in the flower. So when the sun rises and the flower, lotus flower especially, when lotus flower blossoms, so the bee goes inside and sits. And when the sun is setting, the lotus flower again closes and the bee remains tucked inside and it dies. So now one may blame the sun. Oh, because of sun, this bee has died. But can someone blame the sun? Because sun is not doing anything. Sun is just doing his own work. He did not rise with the intention that I will kill the bee. He doesn't rise with that intention. He is just doing his duty, rising and setting. So those things are going on. But the people will get affected. Like some may say, oh, that is so hot. Already it is summer season and the sun is coming. So it is like you don't like it. But you can't blame the sun because sun is just doing his duty. Sun is neutral. And sun is not affected by your comments also. Like sometimes some people may comment about us that he is like this, he is like that. So immediately we get affected, we feel insulted. Oh, how can he say? But sun is neutral. He is not affected by all these happenings in this world. So similarly, the Lord is not affected by that. So Lord is a neutral personality. And the 10th verse, which is one of the very important and very easy verse for recitation also, memorization. Very good verse. Anyone, this is a verse which you can quote anywhere. If some people ask, oh, what is about this material nature? What is the relation of Krishna with that? So this verse actually tells what is the relation. Okay, please recite. Maya adhyakshena prakritihi.
Maya adhyakshena prakritihi.
Suyate sa characharam.
ुएते
जगद्विपरिवर्तते
The material nature, which is one of my energies, is working under my direction. O son of Kunti, producing all moving and all moving beings. Under its rule, this manifestation is created and annihilated again.
Yeah. So this material nature, which is one of my energy only, is working under my direction. So here Krishna is telling that this is working under my direction. Even though everything is happening by my energy, but that energy is working under my direction. So that's why it is said that this is such a confidential knowledge, because there are so many scriptures and different scriptures are there. People ask that why, if there are so many gods or religions, why gods or we say, how can there be one God? Like that they ask question. So here it is said Krishna, because all other, whoever are the demigods or whoever, they never said that, all this maya adhyakshana prakriti, everything is working under my direction. But Krishna is telling this. That's why it is most confidential knowledge. Producing all moving and non-moving beings. He is only creator, and under its rule, manifestation is created and annihilated again and again. So it is sometimes creation happens, sometimes annihilations, everything is happening. But that is also happening with Krishna's observation only. So one question which always people ask that, okay, why Krishna created such kind of complex world, you know, that he creates something and we have to suffer so much for that. Like some of us already have undergone certain suffering, because by this time everybody has gone some suffering in this life, and there is some faith. We also have this material world is suffering. We can't be happy, and no, we don't see also any person being happy in this world. We only see people happy in the spiritual world. So, but then one question comes that why Krishna gives such kind of suffering, or why he has created this? He says that everything is working under my direction. That means the material nature also. Then why does he makes the material nature to force us, or what we say, we are undergoing certain miseries. Why he allows the material nature to do that? He can just say that, oh, all the living entities, let them enjoy whatever they want to do, and you should not interfere in them. So why doesn't he do that? So basically Krishna, there is one Gaurang Darshan Prabhu, he does this analogy of a mela. Like mela, there are different games are there. Like, you know, that when there are some kind of small, what we say, Akash Jula, we say in Marathi, I don't know English, what we call that? Anyone knows?
Giant wheel.
Giant wheel, yeah, correct. So in that giant wheel, when people are sitting there in those compartments, and one goes very up. So while going up, it is very, 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 what we say, people like it, it's going up. But as soon as it's coming down, people become very fearful that I may fall down or what will happen. So it's a kind of that. And especially...
Merry-go-round.
Okay, yeah, that is also there. So that's how we see that people are going there, but some people are getting fun by doing like that. And there are some people who become very afraid. And once they sit there, then you can't, in between, you can't get out also. And then after some time, when they actually come out, they say that, oh, can they blame the person who is the in charge for that? Can they say, oh, because of you, so much fearful I was, why did you allow me to do this? So can he say like that? Can he blame the owner of that person?
No,
he can't do that, because it was his own free will. It was his own choice that he wanted to sit there out of his curiosity or whatever he wanted to sit. But there was warning given that, okay, if you are a heart patient or you have heart problem, then you should not enter here. So by knowing that a person who is having heart problem, he should not go inside. But still this person goes and suffers. So that is his own choice. So similarly, the living entities, Krishna has told that this is a dukkhalayam ashashvatam, that this material world, what you will get is only dukkhalayam. It's a misery is what you are going to get. then we choose, no, I want to go because we have independent desire. So then we go and we suffer, and then we can't blame Krishna. Why Krishna is giving me this? Why Krishna has put me under this material nature and so much trouble, so many problems I have in my life? Why it is happening? Why Krishna is doing like that with me? So immediately such kind of people, many people ask this. When good things happen, they don't go to God. Why you have given me this good thing? I didn't want it first rank in my college, but still you have given. So nobody asks for that. But when bad thing happen, immediately they point out, oh, why you did it? So that is what is the response from the people. But here Krishna says that actually everything is working under him, but he is not the person who has put you into that. He just created that because there are living entities who are desiring this material world. So for them, Krishna created, and we are also entering into that. So that's not Krishna's mistake in that. It is our mistake and our independent mentality, which we wanted to lord over, and we are getting now the experience, or we can say it's like a punishment we are getting here. So we have to reform ourselves and again go back to Godhead. So that is what we can do. So also there is one analogy given of hotel. In hotel, when you go, there are different items being served. Some rice is there, chapati is there, some pulao is there, pakoda is there, and sweet is there. So different items will be there. And sometimes a person is having some fever, like cold is there, and he eats some ice cream or something, which is very cold. So after eating, his cough increases. So you can't blame the hotel person. Oh, why you gave me such chilly thing, what we say, chilled ice cream. He can't say that because you ordered, I gave it. So it is not a problem of the hotel person, but it is a problem of that particular living entity who is suffering because of his so-called choices. So what choices we make in our life, that is only makes us suffer. So we can't blame the God. That is what is the application point we can get through this particular verse. So this was today's particular discussion, where we saw that Krishna is doing certain things, but he is not into that. Like he says that I am 4th to 10th, we have seen these 6-7 verses where Krishna says that I have created everything, but I am not in them, means I am not dependent on them. Whereas they are dependent on me, at the same time, they does not rest in me. That means that I am detached from them, because even if they are doing certain things, I am detached from them. So that's how Krishna explains. And then he tells about his particular creation, annihilation, how does it take place and all. And that's how he goes there. So any doubts you have, you can ask any question, because this particular section is little, Krishna is contradicting his own statements. So it requires little, maybe you have to contemplate on this, whatever we have discussed today. After this session or in coming days, whenever you get time, you can read these verses with the purpose also and try to understand the entire thing. So, and whatever analogies we told, these analogies actually help us to understand the workings, how Krishna is working in this world. What is his relationship? So that is like one analogy I remember is about the fragrance of a flower. So that also is given by Prabhupada. Prabhupada says that when a flower is there, it's very fragrant. And the person who is just going, passing through that place, he will experience the fragrance will come and he will experience that. But if you see, the fragrance and the flower is separated. At the same time, fragrance is coming from the flower itself. But flower is aloof. The flower is not attached to that fragrance. Fragrance is gone and he has his own fragrance also. So that is what is Supreme Lord. There are so many living entities. Everything is coming from him. The entire creation, the cosmic manifestation and the living entities, everything is coming from him, but he is not attached to them. So even though they are his energies only, but they are separate. So that's how we have seen this 10 verses today, 6-7 verses. So here we end for today. Any questions you can ask me, otherwise we end for today for discussion. So thank you very much for your kind attention. And just one announcement I want to make. In the 31st August, today is 8th August, and on 31st August, 30 August is the Janmashtami, and 31st August is a Prabhupada appearance day festival, which is 125th appearance day. and all over the world, very nice celebration. They are doing many other things also, how to make this festival. And of course, throughout the day, throughout the year, they are doing different activities to just make this 125 years very special for Prabhupada. Some are doing 125 Lilamrit set distribution, some are doing 125 books distribution, or 125 villages. One devotee had taken vow that he will do Harinam Sankirtan in 125 villages. So like that, different things are there. And we also have this particular thing which I thought that all of you can also contribute. That is basically the writing. Like all of our birthday comes and we write certain things and we give as a gift to the other devotee. We say, okay, you are a very nice, wonderful devotee, and we glorify him and give him, because we feel that whatever he has done in our life, it has helped us to improve our own consciousness. So we glorify that devotee or any person who is having birthday. So this is Prabhupada's 125th birthday. And because of Prabhupada only, today we are here discussing on this Gita, which Prabhupada has given in such a lucid manner. So if you can just take out, there is a 1250, these many offerings. Of course, it is very less where we have 6,000 devotees in Pune. 1250 offerings they are told to submit. So I thought that all of you can also do that. So one offering you have to write on your name. And when you write your some gratitude towards your spiritual father, no, like Prabhupada is our guru. And when we glorify him, that will help us to receive his message through the books or his lectures, which we hear very nicely. So all of you can take out some time. You can even read something about Prabhupada and try to make a kind of offering, a letter of glorification to Prabhupada, where you can glorify him for his what contribution Prabhupada has done and how it helped in my own life, like some incident or some kind of statements in his books which helped me to become more serious. So those things you can write, and that will be very helpful. Okay, so details we will share with you. I just wanted to announce about this. So thank you very much for your kind attention. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
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 Thank you, Prabhupada.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji.
Thank you. Hare Bol.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare
Krishna. Thank you, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.